So Meaghan, thank you for being here. We've had a few great sessions today. You had a great presentation in our COIL conversation. We've had a few open dialogues with students and with faculty. But what we tried to do here during Perspectives is to take thought leaders in the field, such as yourself, sit down with them and just ask them three questions. And the questions all have to do with student retention, which is one of the themes for COIL for this year. So the first question we put out is really how you define student retention, or what does student retention mean to you in the context of online learning? Because often you can get five people at a table and ask them that question and define retention. You either get blank stares or five different answers.
Right.
So what does retention mean to you in the context of online learning?
So I think I understand retention in two different ways. My my full-time job as executive director of the Personalized Learning Consortium at the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities, we take a very institutional focused approach to retention, and we've really seen it in the context of degree completion and helping American research universities and North America generally, because of course we have international members, but helping our member institutions close attainment gaps and increase the number of credentials that they are providing and the number of students that are attaining degrees and moving on to gainful employment. I think in a personal context, I work as an adjunct and an associate lecturer at the University of Massachusetts at Boston, and I've been teaching there now for coming up on 13 years in a fully distance environment, so completely online. And for me, in that context, retention really does mean that my students persist in that course to a successful outcome and encounter no academic hurdles that they can't surmount. Right. So certainly I have students that are forced to drop or withdraw for personal reasons, but that retention for me is about making sure that every student that wants to complete the course successfully has the support to do so and also meets the quality standards that we have as a public research university in Boston.
Yeah. And so the ideal is to help those students pass those hurdles.
Yes.
To bring them to those goals that sometimes they're defining for themselves. So what their educational goals are.
Yes.
So that's what many institutes of higher education are struggling with right now, is how do we do that?
Yes.
So let me paint a rosy picture for you.
Sure.
And this is a picture in which the normal constraints that we work under, the time, the money, the capacity, let's set those aside for a moment. And let's paint your utopic vision. Let's paint your ideal vision of what can we be doing as institutes of higher education or public land-grant universities? Mm-hmm. What can we be doing to help students toward that goal of attaining their educational objectives? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think that it's about creating a culture in that educational environment where people are working as a team to support that student, understanding their various functional roles. So, you know, our faculty members are generally responsible for the content, the academic certification, so to speak. But we've got a team of advisors and administrators that are really responsible for seeing the larger picture and understanding that what's happening academically is not happening in a vacuum, and that students are well informed both by one another and by the communities in which they live and work and learn, and then by their universities institutionally about the services that are available to them when they need them, and that the interventions that we have are portrayed either as optional and recommended or as required, because we have a contract with you through the admissions process that we're going to help you achieve. And for us, achieving is ending in a degree in a reasonable amount of time, not simply getting a grade at the end of a term and re-enrolling the next term.
Yeah. So from your perspective, what we've been talking about today with adaptive platforms, where can adaptive learning platforms or adaptive approaches play into this?
So the focus on adaptive learning is a support, a leg of a stool potentially, in a strategy around improving retention and closing attainment gaps. And it's really on that latter part that it can be incredibly impactful. If we can take a student and get a sense of what they brought in terms of knowledge and skills into a course, we can better move them through a course experience or through a set of learning activities to an outcome that they're happy with and that prepares them for life,
yeah.
for work,
yeah.
or for the next learning experience. And so if we think about the attainment gaps that students can have for a variety of different reasons, right? It can be in terms of background, it can be socioeconomic, it can be confidence, it can be all sorts of non-cognitive
yeah.
things, or it can simply be the readiness and the preparation that they have being college ready and coming in to a university like Pennsylvania State. So I think that we think about adaptive learning technologies as being able to provide a data-rich and data-informed learning experience, one that helps the instructors, and in this case, you know, faculty members who bring a wealth of knowledge about the content into an engagement with a student where that student's skills and proficiencies are more transparent to the educator so that the educator can better respond to the needs of the student. And I think alternative also, by extension, and these technologies don't do this as well yet, can give the learner a much greater understanding of what our expectations are for them
mm-hmm.
in terms of outcomes. That, you know, you've declared this major, but what does that really mean in terms of the knowledge and the skills that I'll acquire between today with what I have, you know, behind me and in front of me and the end result that I've identified as my career goal or my educational goal.
It's taking learning out of that black box
right.
Where you put a student in front of a faculty member, magic happens,
right.
and they leave, and
exactly.
they know something.
Exactly.
So giving them an yeah. insight into
we've just met, but somehow you're supposed to dramatically transform everything that I know. You know nothing about me. I know nothing about you. I can't think of a greater recipe for disaster. But if mm-hmm. we can come into this enterprise with a better understanding of one another's knowledge sets, and expectations, we can kind of level that playing field. And by extension, we really empower a learner
yeah.
to take greater responsibility for their education. And we give a set of educators some tools that they may not know it today, but that they really would enjoy using because it will make them more powerful teachers.
So say, I'm inspired by the vision.
Okay.
The idea
great. My job is
great.
Done.
But tomorrow I have to come into work
yeah.
and I have to do something.
Mm-hmm.
So tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
next week, next month, next year, what's that first step or what are those first steps to
right.
getting toward that vision of this transparency, of this
mm-hmm.
knowing one another?
Seek out an individual in your discipline. So you're talking to a peer, a faculty member at another institution that is using an adaptive learning technology to a greater or lesser degree. And I don't really care which vendor it is, but inform yourself by talking to a peer about what is available to you in your discipline and then make a decision about whether or not you're willing to invest your time in using that technology with a student or with a cohort of students in a course to understand what the potential is for that solution for you in the environment where you work and teach. And then share that experience with the people in your department.
That's great. And that's a great first step. Let me also ask, what about your organization, the PLC? Where,
mm-hmm.
where are you located in this?
So, well, physically we're in Washington, D.C., and we serve all of the public research universities in a membership association. And then the Personalized Learning Consortium is 20 of those universities that have intentionally gathered as a group to pursue the personalization of learning
mm-hmm.
using technology. And that last phrase is really important. There's lots of ways to improve and to personalize education. We're focused, our lens is really how do we do this with education technologies that exist today,
mm-hmm.
not, you know, Star Trek stuff that
yeah.
we wish existed.
Yeah.
And what were we doing to further that? It's along the lines of the answer I gave you, you know, to that individual faculty member. We are creating occasions and opportunities for the faculty at our member institutions to do what I said, to do it with some external funding,
mm-hmm.
And to do it in ways that will drive and achieve scale in the deployments of these solutions. Because as much as I want that first step to be the individual faculty member making the choice to explore and to potentially use the technology, organizationally, my goal is to get every student at every public research university enrolled in a course with an adaptive component.
Excellent. Well, thank you. You are helping us along that path with the discussions we've been having today and helping to enlighten us all as to what platforms are available, the idea behind it, and the vision of where we can be in the future. So thank you for being
My
here.
My pleasure. Thank
and
you for having
it.
Me. It's been a great day.